It's the light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Welcome, Talk Catholic, the website.com. Your host, Tim Kilcoyne. No agendas here, just the straight and narrow. Through Mary to Jesus, the Catholic faith proclaimed and preserved. Hope to see you here every week.
TalkCatholic.com with Tim Kilcoyne, and we will continue on with our series on the diabolical disorientation coming from any number of angles, and especially the erection of a state church really before our very eyes ever so gradually. But this is our last Saturday of the month, and thus Saint of the month, and he is Saint Augustine. But first, I got a little glance to share my personal anecdotal this week. I was in a restaurant with a wonderful fellow disciple in Christ, and we were talking about some basic age-old theological differences between men and women. God forbid, in this unisex culture of death that we currently live in. But in the spirit of St. Thomas Aquinas, we simply spoke to one another. And there was a particular couple that was sitting right next to us, and I noticed that they weren't having any discussion with one another, and they had sour looks on their face. They were intent on listening to our conversation, and then ever so gradually, the gentleman spoke up in a not-so-gentlemanly way and indicated that they were outraged by the thrust of our conversation. And then the woman made her vehement disagreements more loudly known in a public place. This is not the first time that I've experienced this, also in a restaurant about a year ago, where one gentleman just gets up out of his booth and says, "I don't like the nature of what you're talking about." Oh, this is the new America, ladies and gentlemen. If we don't fight back very quickly, because they are ruthless, watch out, because this is freedom of speech under assault like never before. Whether the people next to you in the local restaurant agree or disagree, number one, it's your right of speech and privacy, and that is both are being violated when people start attacking you, especially in public places, on the inspiration of certain politicians going back a couple of years, if I remember. Somebody was standing up out there in California telling people to get in their faces wherever you are. Oh, isn't this lovely? So just want to let you know, this is the byproduct of a new state tyrannical religion. It's their religion. They don't want to hear anybody speaking about their religious perspectives and age-old truths. It doesn't jive with their perspective, which is usually godless, atheistic, or at least agnostic. And remember, in the face of such an assault, you always have two courses of action. One can take the image of St. John the Baptist and fire back a nice, articulate, verbal rationale for exactly your position. Or you stay silent, as Jesus did in the face of Pontius Pilate himself. Either Christian posture is all under Christ, but at least be aware of your volume, because these are the very same people that would report you for not wearing the mask over the course of the last year. It is Gestapo-like, and I think it's time to bring that word back into colloquial conversation. Basic rule of combat, identify the enemy. In any event, we shall see that this intolerant frame of mind is nothing new, characteristic of the city of man, as opposed to the city of God. And we will be talking about that great work of St. Augustine shortly. I'd like to read from the website catholic.org a bit of his bio. Augustine of Hippo is the patron of brewers because of his conversion from a former life of loose living, which included parties, entertainment, and worldly ambitions. His complete turnaround and conversion has been an inspiration to many who struggle with a particular vice or habit they long to break. This famous son of St. Monica was born in Africa and spent many years of his life in wicked living and in false beliefs. Though he was one of the most intelligent men who ever lived, and though he had been brought up Christian, his sins of impurity and his pride darkened his mind so much that he could not see or understand the divine truth anymore. Through the prayers of his Holy Mother and the marvelous preaching of St. Ambrose, Augustine finally became convinced that Christianity was the one true religion. Yet he did not become a Christian then because he thought he could never live a pure life. One day, however, he heard about two men who had suddenly been converted on reading the life of St. Anthony, and he felt terribly ashamed of himself. "What are we doing?" he cried to his friend Alypius. "Unlearned people are taking heaven by force, while we, with all our knowledge, are so cowardly that we keep rolling around in the mud of our sins." Full of bitter sorrow, Augustine flung himself out into the garden and cried out to God, "How long more, O Lord? Why does not this hour put an end to my sins?" Just then he heard a child singing, "Take up and read." Thinking that God intended him to hear those words, he picked up the book of the letters of St. Paul and read the first passage his gaze fell on. It was just what Augustine needed, for in it, St. Paul says, to put away all impurity and to live in the imitation of Jesus. That did it. From then on, Augustine began a new life. He was baptized, became a priest, a bishop, a famous Catholic writer, founder of religious priests, and one of the greatest saints that ever lived. He became very devout and charitable, too. On the wall of his room, he had the following sentence written in large letters, "Here we do not speak evil of anyone." St. Augustine overcame strong heresies, practiced great poverty, and supported the poor, preached very often, and prayed with great fervor right up until his death. "Too late have I loved you," he once cried to God, but with his holy life, he certainly made up for his sins that he committed before his conversion. His feast day is August 28th. St. Augustine's life was between 354 and 430, and his writings influenced the development of Western philosophy and Western Christianity, and he is viewed as one of the most important church fathers of the Latin Church in the patristic period. His many important works include The City of God, On Christian Doctrine, and Confessions. According to his contemporary, Jerome, Augustine established anew the ancient faith. In his youth, he was drawn to the major Persian religion, Manichaeanism, and later to Neoplatonism. After his conversion to Christianity and baptism in 386, Augustine developed his own approach to philosophy and theology, accommodating a variety of methods and perspectives. Believing the grace of Christ was indispensable to human freedom, he helped formulate the doctrine of original sin and made significant contributions to the development of the just war theory. When the Western Roman Empire began to disintegrate, Augustine imagined the church as a spiritual city of God, distinct from the material earthly city. His thoughts profoundly influenced the medieval worldview. Augustine is recognized as a saint in the Catholic Church, the Eastern Orthodox Church, and the Anglican Communion. He is also a preeminent Catholic doctor of the Church and the patron of the Augustinians. In 391, Augustine was ordained a priest in Algeria. He became a famous preacher. More than 350 preserved sermons are believed to be authentic. He was noted for combating the Manichaean religion, to which he had formerly adhered. He preached around 6,000 to 10,000 sermons when he was alive. However, there are only around 500 sermons accessible today. Some of his sermons would last over 1 hour, and he would preach multiple times throughout a given week. When talking to his audience, he would stand on an elevated platform. However, he would walk toward the audience during his sermons. When he was preaching, he used a variety of rhetorical devices that included analogies, word pictures, similes, metaphors, repetition, and antithesis when trying to explain more about the Bible. In 395, he was made coadjutor bishop of Hippo and became full bishop shortly thereafter, hence the name Augustine of Hippo, and he gave his property to the Church of Thagaste, Africa. He remained in that position until his death in 430. As bishop, he wrote his Confessions in 397 and 398. His work, The City of God, was written to console his fellow Christians shortly after the Visigoths had sacked Rome in 410. According to Pisidius, Augustine spent his final days in prayer and repentance, requesting the penitential Psalms of David be hung on his walls so he could read them. Augustine was canonized by popular acclaim and later recognized as a doctor of the church in 1298 by Pope Boniface VIII. In addition to patron saint of brewers, he is also looked up to by printers, theologians, and a number of cities and dioceses. He is also invoked against sore eyes, probably from lusting after too many pretty women for too long. You see, I can simply say I have a book on my personal shelf here, scoundrels to saints. We have many of them in the history of the church. Thank the Lord. His grace is never exclusionary to the elect, quote unquote. These are real people, not pie in the sky figurative people with halos that never sinned. These are the people like you and me. And sometimes it might have been a sordid past, and his was such, no question about it. And logically, he felt a tremendous need to do reparation and atonement for the sins of his youth, which again was characterized mostly by extreme promiscuity. I think many know the problem, and yet he kept at it and kept speaking to God in the same spirit of King David, who had the same problem, if you remember. Now let's take a look at some of his great works and themes. So I'm just going to highlight a few major concepts of St. Augustine. One regarding human sexuality. Augustine taught that human sexuality had been wounded together with the whole of human nature and requires redemption of Christ. That healing is a process realized in conjugal acts. The virtue of continence is achieved thanks to the grace of the sacrament of Christian marriage, which becomes therefore a remedy of concupiscence, which is the inordinate desire of the flesh. The redemption of human sexuality will be, however, fully accomplished only in the resurrection of the body. The sin of Adam is inherited by all human beings. Augustine was the first to add the concept of inherited guilt from Adam, whereby an infant was eternally damned at birth. This concept was not picked up by future church councils, but was rather his own opinion, but may well have had something to do with the importance of infant baptism and not delaying it. Now, regarding the Eucharist, Augustine upheld the early Christian understanding of the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist, saying that Christ's statement, "This is my body," referred to the bread he carried in his hands, and that Christians must have faith the bread and wine are in fact the body and blood of Christ, despite what they see with their eyes. Very interestingly, he said, "No one eats that flesh unless first he adores it. And not only do we not sin by adoring, we do sin by not adoring." Makes me wonder what percentage of those who receive communion by hand spend time regularly in adoration. A very important point to ponder these days, as those who receive by the mouth have been made to feel like second-class citizens in too many parishes, that's for sure, since the break of the pandemic. Now let's take a look at what St. Augustine might be most famous for, which is his just war theory. Augustine asserted Christians should be pacifists as a personal philosophical stance. However, peacefulness in the face of a grave wrong that could only be stopped by violence would be a sin. Defense of oneself or others could be a necessity, especially when authorized by a legitimate authority. While not breaking down the conditions necessary for war to be just, Augustine coined the phrase in his work, The City of God. In essence, the pursuit of peace must include the option of fighting for its long-term preservation. Such a war could not be preemptive but defensive to restore peace. Thomas Aquinas, centuries later, used the authority of Augustine's arguments in an attempt to define the conditions under which a war could be just. I often refer to our Lord in praising the faith of the centurion, the Roman soldier who was so believing in our Lord's simple word, "Only say the word and my servant will be healed." We have no indication that our Lord told him to drop his swords and come and follow Jesus. He simply let him go and then turned to the crowd and said, "What faith I have not seen in all of Israel." So it's a very powerful foreshadowing of the legitimacy of war under certain circumstances. Now, on the concept of free will, Augustine said, "God created humans and angels as rational beings possessing free will. Free will was not intended for sin, meaning it is not equally predisposed to both good and evil. A will defiled by sin is not considered as free as it once was because it is bound by material things, which could be lost or be difficult to part with, resulting in unhappiness. Sin impairs free will while grace restores it." And St. Augustine did have something to say about religious freedom and or coercion. He had to deal with the issues of violence and coercion throughout his entire career, due largely to the Donatist Catholic conflict. During the great persecution, when Roman soldiers came calling, some of the Catholic officials handed over the sacred books and other church goods rather than risk legal penalties. The sacred scriptures were not simply books to them, but were the word of God in physical form, and therefore they saw handing over the Bible and handing over a person to be martyred as two sides of the same coin. Those who cooperated with the authorities, we're talking the Romans here, became known as traditores, traitors. Augustine did assert that coercion could not directly convert someone, but did conclude it could make a person ready to be reasoned with. Augustine saw coercion as one of the many conversion strategies for forming a pathway to the inner person. In Augustine's view, there is such a thing as just and unjust persecution. Augustine explains that when the purpose of persecution is to lovingly correct and instruct, then it becomes discipline and is just. So in other words, ladies and gentlemen, St. Augustine was a spare not the rod kind of guy, and I don't think he'd be favoring today's safe spaces on college campuses. Let's take a break. This is WQPH Radio 89.3 FM. When we come back, we'll take a look at the quotables from St. Augustine. Okay, from the website azquotes.com, here are some of St. Augustine's favorites. And the first one might be that which he is most known for. Because God has made us for himself, our hearts are restless until they rest in him. Nothing could perhaps haunt the person that is not living in God's grace, knowing that there's something more and something missing in their life. And even amongst those who may look like they've got it all together, usually there's still something missing if they don't have God in their life. And that includes family, spouse, friends. None of it means all too much unless God is front and center. I have said to some wayward friends over the years, you may leave the baptismal grace, but the baptismal grace never leaves you. It's time to come home. One particular lad would always say, not yet. Which were the very words of St. Augustine regarding his frivolous lifestyle at one time. So no need to put off what you can do today for Jesus. Be with him. Make him front and center, and then let the chips fall. Too many of us will hide out in family life. Family may not be the place where God is front and center, and people masquerade in an air of togetherness when God is really not part of the fabric. Just remember, the mafia, gangs of any kind, doesn't lead to heaven. They're pretty tight, but what good is it? I've said before, there's only one family, you know, God's family, and it's the only one that matters. And we only hope and pray that our biological families are on the path. But they might not be. So beware of the people, the friends, even the spouses, whomever, that might be preventing you from that closeness to our Lord in fulfilling his will for you. As a saying on a brochure I once created, home is where his heart is, his sacred heart, and your true heart fulfilled. Do God's will. The next quote, there is no saint without a past, no sinner without a future. Oh, beautiful. As I've said before, one of my books is here entitled From Scoundrel to Saint. The saints are real people. And the reason that they become so much greater after God's grace has touched them later on is that they know all the dynamics of sin. They know what the sordid past is all about, and they can be much greater teachers, therefore, because of it. So rest assured, saints don't grow on trees, not popping in like manna from heaven, but rather they are forged through the experiences of life that we all share. And on the flip side is the fact that no sinner doesn't have a future. There is always hope. And I'm reminded right now of the old line, the next time the devil reminds you of your past, just remind him of his future. And you'll get by and you'll get through. This too will pass. The next quote. Here's a great one for our times right now, especially the past year. The truth is like a lion. You don't have to defend it. Let it loose, it will defend itself. And of course, the problem has been, over the course of the last year, that there's been a lot of lies. And the people that are perpetrating these lies do not want to join a speech and debate club. They're not interested in putting forth their positions in an articulate and logical way anywhere. They just want to make sure the other side doesn't have that forum. Doesn't that pretty much tell you who's guilty as sin itself? The truth indeed has a ring to it. And one of my prayers, by the way, throughout the course of the whole past year, has been very simple. Father, may the truth rise to the top. May the truth just completely overwhelm the darkness of all the falsehoods that are in the spheres of government, media, the church, and family life. May your holy truth shine over it all by the triumphant heart of Our Lady. Totally overwhelm the enemy. And I pray special prayers to St. Athanasius of Alexandria, St. Thomas Aquinas, and Pope St. Pius X for their fierce defense of the Holy Roman Catholic faith during the turbulent times of their lives and the enemies descending upon them at the time. Those are the people we need right now. I would suggest, in addition, somebody that is not declared a saint, but Monsignor Hugh O'Flaherty, whose story was depicted in the old movie The Scarlet and the Black, who did so much great work during the Nazi days over at the Vatican trying to hide prisoners from the death camps. I think he'd be a really good one to pray hard to right now. Here's one from St. Augustine that needs no explanation, but perhaps we should put it forth as a prayer. A Christian is a mind through which Christ thinks, a heart through which Christ loves, a voice through which Christ speaks, and a hand through which Christ helps. Amen. Here's a great one. Take care of your body as if you were going to live forever. Take care of your soul as if you were going to die tomorrow. Well, the wellness society that we live in certainly does the former in thinking that the body's going to live forever. So we do a heck of a job on vitamins and health clubs and massage and yoga techniques to keep our bodies, which are temples of the Holy Spirit, in good shape. But unfortunately, if we don't do the latter in taking care of the soul as if we could be gone tomorrow to meet our Maker, then what good was any of it? Because that body is going to die and the soul will be before our Lord. Now, of course, on the other hand, it is also true that sometimes we give ourselves to the cerebral and the spiritual, and we don't really take care of ourselves physically. And that's not good either, to the soul's detriment. There's an old book, I believe the title, Holiness is Wholeness. Well, indeed, we have to bring it all together, body, mind, and soul. There's a prayer that I also offer up often. Keep my mind and body pure and my soul holy, Lord, and to Our Lady as well. Keep my mind and body and soul holy. Help me to work at all three. Because remember, the devil's greatest playground is between the ears. Protect me, Lord, so I can be that integrated whole that you have created me to be. Amen. And we are indeed out of time. So check out that website, azquotes.com, and punch in to the search St. Augustine to take a look at some of so many quotes that I could rattle off. We could do 50 shows on St. Augustine. All right, God bless everybody. Make someone happy, as the old song says. As you begin the new school year, to St. Thomas Aquinas, protect our students, Lord. This is WQPH Radio 89.3 FM. Let your light shine. That is what it's all about here at WQPH Radio 89.3 FM. But we need to hear your story. You want your voice to be his voice. That is making the faith known to others. Please, my number is 877-625-3727. Tim Kilcoyne, talkcatholic.com. St. Mother Teresa told us, your ministry is your work right where you are. Grab on to this microphone. God bless.